later or who are watching from home or listening from home. And it means that if you ask a question, you'll be voice recorded, but your face will not be captured because we're not going to spend the Wally type creature here. So I just want to welcome you to New Dramatists and to what has become our annual town hall meeting. And we started these meetings, these sessions a couple of years ago as a way to both explain and demystify the admissions process for those who are interested in applying, those who have applied in the past and want to know more about the procedure, and also to field any questions you might have about the residency itself. So we can help answer those questions. I'm Madeleine Morse. I'm the Director of Artistic Development, and I'm the incoming Artistic Director, and I'll introduce our panelists. And I would love to then just hear, I would love you to introduce yourself so we have faces and names attached and we can save some room. That's Morgan Allen, our tech guru over there, is on staff, New Dramatist.
I'm Rachel Hutt, I'm the Artistic Programs Administrator here.
I'm Todd London. I've been the Artistic Director here for the last 18 years. And I have 5 more days.
Sir, hi.
I'm Ed Filardi.
Mary Catherine Neal.
Drew Sachs.
My name's Paul Adams. I'm a playwright. This is my little shot.
Great.
You're in good company.
Yeah.
Stacey Rose.
I didn't see it.
I'm Jerry Alexander.
Hi, I'm Joanne
Marina.
I'm Julia Doolittle.
Hi, everyone. Dale
Perrott. I'm John Willinger.
I'm Susan Haddon-Becky.
Hi, I'm Stephen Baldwin.
Paul David Young.
George Grant.
Hi, we're Dave Clemens. And just joining us,
John Steber.
He's the director of the Playwrights Lab. Also will be a great resource for any questions you might have about the residency. So, Todd?
Let me just give a little context and apologize ahead of time that I am going to slip out early. I'm about to move my family 3,000 miles across the country and there's a lot to do. but I wanted to be here today one final time for this. So I've been here for 18 years at New Dramatists as artistic director, and one of the things that we all inherited, which I feel proudest of at this place, is the admissions processes. And I know that's what we're here to introduce everybody to today, or try and clarify, and as Emily said, demystify. The reason that I feel particularly proud of it is because despite the fact that it is immensely frustrating to about 495 people every year, and despite the fact that those of us who are on staff here have always wished that we could serve more playwrights directly, it is in fact about as fair as any kind of selection process I've ever seen or been part of. And part of that fairness, I think, is in the integrity of the conversations, in the way the process is articulated, and we'll make that clear today. Part of the fairness is in the very randomness of it, and the fact that the people who decide each year, we're not sitting up here because we only facilitate the process and don't weigh in at all. But the fact that the people who decide every year, a panel of 7 made up of 3 current writers, New Dramatists resident playwrights, 2 former or alumni resident playwrights, and 2 outside theater professionals, part of the fairness is that they change every year so that there is no monolithic group weighing in on you as a playwright. There is no sense of like New Dramatists is looking for this kind of playwright or that kind of playwright. and as the person who has principally and with Emily facilitated the discussions, which you'll hear how they go, for 18 years, I've seen a years that the process went better than others in terms of everybody being heard and reaching a true consensus. But I've never really seen a process that was whimsical or in any way monolithic, that wasn't a true and incredibly passionate and honest attempt by the panel to define their collective values on behalf of this organization. So, and part of the way that I've known from year to year that it works, even though, again, every year only about 1% of the people who apply get in, is that it changes so radically from year to year. So that one year, someone will be eliminated in the first round who will be like a shoo-in the next year. Sometimes someone, I think you said four times, sometimes there'll be people who apply 10, 12 times and get in, and they, even they feel it's the right moment for them to get in. You know, I was looking back, as I'm cleaning out my office, I came upon a piece of our oral history that we've been doing for the last, I don't know, 15 years or so. And one of the stories that was a mystery to me until about a year ago was how we came to have seven-year residencies. Because when New Dramatists started 65 years ago, in 1949, there was no sense that it would be a lasting organization at all. There really was a sense of, we want to help playwrights. There were no MFA programs at the time. There was no off-off Broadway, really no off-Broadway, no regional theater to speak of. It was just beginning. There were no opportunities for playwrights to learn their craft except on Broadway, and who learns their craft on Broadway? So the sort of that catch-22 that every playwright always feels, which is, how do I get my plays produced? You know, if you haven't produced my plays, you know, if nobody knows me because I haven't been produced, was like extreme in 1949. And so the organization was created by a playwright and her friends and the support of some of the lions of the Dramatists Guild through their, you know, through the beseeching of these unknown playwrights. And it was just established as kind of playwrights in a room with free tickets to Broadway, a chance to have craft discussions with their seniors, their elders in a way, a chance to read their work to each other. And these were very sort of small and informative programs, but it was the only way for playwrights to be together. And what they never thought about was how long people would stay in the organization. So there was kind of a sense that everybody was in it forever. And then there were years where one half of the membership decided the other half was no good and should get the frick out. Or that they hadn't been around and so they weren't helping. And so there were all kinds of formulations. And then sometime in the 70s, a guy named Steve Hardy, who was on staff, was dealing with this kind of internecine, you know, struggle between the playwrights who showed up and the ones who didn't, the ones who were actually working playwrights and the ones who've been in forever. And they created as a community the idea of a seven-year residency. So the very churning of this community and the kind of natural mentorship that happens as people in their fifth and sixth and seventh years help people in their first and second and third years figure out how best to use the lab, how best to use the staff, how best especially to use each other, is something that is always evolving. But the thing that was developed, and I cannot tell you actually how or when it was developed, I know I inherited it 18 years ago, is this process, the equation of the three current writers, two former writers and two outside theater people. We do pick the writers for the committee, and our attempt is always to get all sorts of eclectic aesthetics in the room, generational difference, ethnic and cultural difference, gender parity, every kind of difference and array, the regional, regional, and also professional. So though there are 5 writers each year, we change. Some years we have a dramaturg and a designer, sometimes an actor and a director, sometimes a non-theater writer, but always a chance that over the course of 4 years, or 8 years, or 12 years, or 1 year, everybody has a chance to find their room, and the room has a chance to find you. So I'm immensely proud of the process. We work every year to make sure the conversation that happens is real. Emily and everybody will talk a little bit about some of the changes we've gone through in the last few years as the numbers of applicants has risen because of going paperless and having a blind first round and so on and so forth. But I just want to, and of course I have a horse in the game, or a race, or whatever the metaphor is. I really care about the project, but you hear it again and again, and you hear it from people who go through it. We spent 45 hours between January, March, and May in a room together discussing everyone who's been read. The numbers funnel towards the end. By the end, everyone on the panel, and you'll hear more about this, has read all of the finalists' plays. The discussions are deep, they're searching, they're honest, they're passionate, they're full of conflict and disagreement. And what we do is we aim always for consensus, which we define very clearly for the panel. And although there are hundreds of playwrights in this country who should be here and aren't, I have never had the experience that I can recall in 18 years of someone getting in who I didn't think got in righteously, or deserved to be here. So I say that for what it's worth at the beginning of a new year of this, and because I'm proud of it, and because I feel like it's one of the best things about this place, because also what it does is it ensures you when you do get in, or if you don't, that you know that the staff was not working for or against you. That no one is chosen by anyone who remains to run the programs or unchosen by us, so that we can be as fair, impartial, and as dedicated to advocating for all playwrights, even as we serve maybe 50 at a time. Which seems to me, it's always felt kind of like the people who get upset with not getting in over the process. It feels exclusive, but trust me, for a staff of 8 or 9 to be serving 50 playwrights over a period of 7 years, during which another 50 cycle in, doesn't feel exclusive at all. It feels super plentiful. So those are my parting shots. Good luck. We have a lot to say. I'm going to duck out in about 20 minutes or so.
Thank you. Sure. Thank you. I'm going to echo some of the things that Todd said about the procedure. I think we'll go through the procedure. Rachel is able to provide a live demo of the process through which you would apply. And then I would love to be able to field your questions, because that's ultimately why we're here, is to make sure that you get the answers that you need about the residency, about the procedure. I would just add a couple of things to what Todd said in terms of us picking the committee. I mean, I would say it's more like we assemble the committee because, people, we go out to people, we invite them to participate, they're not available 1 year, so we build the committee with all the intention and that Todd had mentioned, but sometimes it's about, oh, this person's available instead of this one, okay, so then what does that provide for us, and how do we complement that? So it is almost individual to individual building process that we go through to make sure that committee provides as broad a readership as possible to be able to speak to and respond to all kinds of writing styles, content. So I would just say that. And then and we've also done a very good job in encouraging the writers to let us know when they're available, because it is, as Todd was explaining, it's a 9-month commitment, and it's a very rigorous one. And so often they'll know better than we will about what their schedule will allow in terms of the reading, in terms of the meetings, and then the decision making.
So the other thing to know about this while we're in it is that the people on the committee, so they read, they're going to read over 9 months, they're going to read 10 plays every 2 weeks, have 3 meetings that total about 45 hours. This is in the middle of their busy family, teaching, writing, TV, theater, crazy lives. And they essentially don't get paid. I mean, we give them a little bit per play to compensate them, and we feed them when they're in a room together. But the reason they do it is out of their commitment to this community and to other writers. So there's no sense of like, oh yes, once a year I get paid a buttload of money to lord it over a bunch of fledglings. It's pure service. That's all.
No, that's good. We ask the writers, once they're members of New Dramatists or residents of New Dramatists, to do 2 things, or 3 things rather. One is to use the resources of this place fully and openly and frequently. Second is to put New Dramatists in their bios, and the third is to serve on the admissions committee at least once during their residency. And many do, and then many come back and do it as alumni, because then they're, you know, not so scared of it. They know what they're in for and enjoy it. I mean, it's kind of an amazing process. So as you know, so the, our admission window this year opened on July 1st. So we are now accepting applications for the 2014-2015 admissions process. As Todd said, so as that's happening, as you're applying to New Dramatists, we're going to assemble this 7-person committee. So I'm in the process of those asks right now and building the next committee who will go on this 9-month journey with us. 2 years ago, we went paperless, and astonishingly, I mean, we were all kind of underestimating. We knew we would get a jump in applications. Prior to 2 years ago, we were getting about 325-350 applications a year, which seemed like a lot. Once we went paperless, we jumped to 536. And so we had to put into place, which is great. It's like, wow, there's a lot of playwrights around. And one of the things that we needed to do in order to maintain the same schedule of the timeline, and as well as the thoroughness and the ability to communicate to the applicants in a timely fashion, we had to make some adjustments to our procedure in order to accommodate the increase of applicants. So we added to our 7-person committee. So the 7-person committee goes on the 9-month journey. In the sort of first several months of the process, to assist us with that reading, we added a group of 30 alumni, basically volunteers. We went out to our alumni and invited them to commit to reading between 10 and 15 scripts in order to assist the 7-person committee to winnow the numbers in order to maintain our time frame. So that was a major change that occurred, you know, in response to that increase of numbers, that now has kind of been set as what we're carrying forward as our procedure. I mean, the other thing I will say about this process, I think in the same way that Todd was explaining how this organization has evolved, how the 7 years, this process evolves every year. We learn things about how things are done, what works, how it works, and we continue to adapt it to in order to serve all the our applicant pool. So in addition to going paperless 2 years ago, the other part of a significant change was that we eliminated letters of recommendation. So prior to 2 years ago, we had one advantage that could be gotten in this process, which was for an applicant to have a letter of recommendation from either a current resident playwright, an alum, or a board member would automatically put both your A play and B play into circulation to two different readers. It didn't change the status of your status, but it was just ensuring that there would be, you would not be rejected until both your plays were automatically read. Because otherwise we commit to reading your one play, we commit to reading your A play first, and then as you advance in the process, we introduce your B play as well. Right? So you know that you apply with two plays, you determine which is the A play, which is the play that's read first, and which is your B play, which would be added in as you advance in the process. So that was the one advantage that could be had, is that you had these letters of recommendation from a current resident playwright and alum or a board member. Other letters of recommendation were optional and were really of very little to no consequence in your application. Letters of recommendation were not really read or introduced in the actual meetings. Because I don't know if you mentioned this, that the focus of the first two meetings and half of the second meeting is all focused on the work. Conversations that are had by the committee in those meetings in January, mid-March, and early May were really focused on the quality of the work, the passion for the work, the passion for the voice. There were no sort of candidacy matters that were raised or who knew who or what prizes anybody had. It was all about how the committee was responding to the work and the questions that the other committee members might have about what you read. And so that was the content of the course of those discussions was all work focused. So it seemed that here we had these letters of recommendation, dear friends and colleagues of ours who were spending a lot of time and their energy and passion to endorse and support the playwrights who were applying. And it seemed that without any consequence whatsoever to where the leverage, there was no leverage to be gotten. And so it seemed disingenuous to continue accepting letters of recommendation because we say it doesn't matter who you know, it's really about how your work meets the committee and the passion that the committee feels about the work, and then how they, by consensus as a group of seven, winnow the list and ultimately determine the writer's work. So we eliminated them, kind of just across the boards, no, nothing from anybody. When we took this to the Writers' Executive Committee, our Writers' Executive Committee is a volunteer group of writers. Once you're a resident playwright, you can volunteer to be on the Writers' Executive Committee, and they are essentially the policy-making body of this organization. We take to them, we take all matters of policy, staffing, personnel, programming, and they either determine the outcome or influence the outcome or give us feedback on how it should go. So we proposed this to them before making the actual change, and they said, well, this is great. We want a little influence still. This is a community. This is a place that is about community and how to build and support the community. So could we still advocate in favor of someone? So we thought, okay, we could do that. But then to balance that out, we decided to make the whole first round of reading blind, right? So what happens is after we get all the applications, we circulate the list of applicants to the current company only, and they may advocate in favor of one person having both their A and B play read in the first round. So that's what the advocacy is, essentially the same as the letter of recommendation. They don't have to provide a letter. They advocate, we note it, and then we circulate the A and B play to two different readers in the process, unbeknownst to them, which is the A, which is the B, and who even wrote it. So all of that whole process is blind. So that was a fairly new, well, that was a significant change as a result of going paperless and then taking away letters of recommendation and balancing that out of advocacy and fairness to all. And so that was what we did 2 years ago as part of our new process. So
Well, you're not missing this, but just to elaborate on your thing. The other thing about that is that there was something that we lost that was, I think, an important value to us when we went to paperless, which was the ability, based on the numbers, to discuss every play that was read. So once we had this other group reading in the first part, we suddenly had, because we had 500 playwrights is actually 1,000 plays, as opposed to 300 playwrights, which is obviously 600 plays. So we could sort of get to most of those plays that the panel had read, but we can't have a conversation with all the 30 readers now. So what we try to do is, it's kind of this balance, a sort of mitigation of the anonymity of that first part by going blind, by not having the cloud of recommendations, so no one ever sees the recommendation, and by making that little advocacy step where a writer on the current resident playwright can, in effect, kind of save a playwright or make sure that both of their plays get read, to make that anonymous as well. So I don't know, for example, that you are the person, you know, my dear friend, whose, you know, taste I value above all others, is the person who advocated for this right. I don't know that. We are blind to each other until the second round, at which point people start discussing plays in the room together. So it's all our attempt to sort of balance, you know, the mammoth size of the process with the integrity of the small, more intimate process, while eliminating the other thing that Emily didn't say, which I think is important to know, is we were tired of having our beloved playwrights, you know, who weren't yet in, have to ask for recommendations all the time. It's one thing for our colleagues to waste their time writing recommendations that haven't been read, but for you guys to have to, like, call out the favors again for no reason is ridiculous. So that was part of it, too.
Right, because we also didn't carry materials forward. So after each round, you know, all those letters would be shredded, you know, when they weren't in paper form, or, you know, the online digital equivalent at this point. But so that was the other reason that those annual calls to people to write those letters of recommendation became onerous to people, both from the asker and also from the writer. So that is true. And then also an important point to add with this new sort of screening process with the alumni group, that that we did employ a numerical system that we use with our Princess Grace applications as well, or for adjudication process. And that was another thing between year one of paperless and year two of paperless, was that, you know, numbers really don't tell you very much about how you feel about a play. So we also asked for comments from the alumni readers in order to unpack what those numbers meant. We took all of that data to the committee for their, we made recommendations to them about where we felt the natural cuts would be. We posed questions to them that were posed from the readers. And, you know, in almost 100% of the cases in both year one and year two, wherever there were questions from the reader, the committee decided that person should be read and evaluated, because with the question about how they felt about the play or something about the voice, that they felt that they should take that to the first discussion in January to be unpacked. So another part of that, no one gets cut in that first round, that first pre-screening round, until the committee looks at all the list of all the people who are recommended to be cut at that point. And they also may say, they do see the names for that, because it's more about saving someone to go forward in the process, someone that they, at that point, wanted to make sure it was read by the entire committee. But then, so the whole process from, so does that make sense?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. Yeah.
Can I say something as important, because I do have to leave? This is a lot of detail.
Yeah, it's a lot of detail.
And it's, but I want you to, I really want you to know why we provide all this detail. It is our firm desire to not have any of this be a mystery to anybody who's applying. And the one thing you'll never know is who is in the room each year, because we keep that confidential. It's such a small community, and we don't want anybody to feel that someone was passing judgment on, you know, when they can't know what the conversation. We never say what the conversation was. We never send feedback. But what we want you to know, and we want everybody to not know who applies, is what the details of the process are. We want it to be as transparent as possible. And the problem with transparency with something like this is it's a logistical nightmare. So to understand it or see it transparently means to, that you're going to go down into the details a little bit, you know. So I'm sorry, you know, and you can certainly tune them out if there's too much, but it's really our attempt to open it up to you so you understand.
And I think, too, to the important part is exactly that, and also how it's an evolving process, how it is constantly being evaluated every year. Did that work? How could this be better? What makes, you know, so that's also, so you know that it's in a constant, you know, or it's in an annual state of being reevaluated in order to serve you all and the committee better. So, yeah, sorry. I'm sorry.
And then the questions will come back later, yeah. Because then people are like, well, then wait, how did that work? Anyway, thank you for coming today. I'm going to turn it over to these guys entirely, and good luck. You know, may it be all of your years, though we've never had a class this big.
Good luck, thank
you.
So just because that was so detailed, do you have any questions thus far?
No.
Yeah, who has a question? Jay.
Okay, I didn't quite follow what you're talking about, the numerical
thing.
So are you saying that after they're all read by the readers, they're somehow assigned some sort of numerical value?
Yes. And the first, we have to implement a pre-screening, for lack of a better term, a pre-screening round,
okay.
Where you know, every A play, at least an A play, if again you're advocating for the A and B play, are read by the 7-person committee and the 30 alumni, right? In this first, it's called a pre-screening round, right? So it takes place between, say, September and November, okay, and yeah, because we can't discuss all 536 applicants, which is what we used to do. We would just discuss all the applicants. We couldn't. So we have a numerical, we have a numbers, and then we've assigned qualitative terms to those numbers to help standardize, at least for our process, what those numbers mean. Because the first year, we had just numbers, and it was kind of all over the place, as you can expect. So the second year, we added qualitative terms to help focus how the numbers would be assigned to each play that was read by the alumni and the committee.
And then it becomes like a score or something?
Essentially, yeah. I mean, it's like 9 to 2, right? The scale is 9 to 2, 9 being the highest, 4.
Okay.
And then 2 being the lowest, or and then they also put comments. They explain why they gave that number, and that's what, when I was referring to some of those middle, especially the middle numbers are very hard. 4, 5, and 6 are sometimes difficult to gauge. So we would read the comments, and if there was anything that the reader was questioning about why they gave that number, we actually took those matters to the committee to decide, does this play move forward or does this play get cut at this point? But does that make sense? And so then after that, we have a meeting, we have a phone conference in November. I know, it's crazy.
I feel more sorry for all of you now than
I
did.
You
it disappeared into a vacuum, and then, you know, there you are, this whole process.
Yeah.
One quick, I don't know about other questions. Just quickly, in terms of musicals, you have actually included one song. So is that listened to during the first process?
Yes.
Okay.
Any reader who is assigned to a play, because the plays are assigned, they read 10 plays. The committee reads 10 plays every 2 weeks. The alumni read 10 to 15 plays by a certain deadline in the fall. And if there is music assigned to the music, if they're assigned a musical that has music, absolutely. All of the material for the play are given to the reader to read and evaluate at that time. Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. Good. Let me go back here, and then I'm going to go here to Sexy. Sorry.
Shakespearean
abs. Oh, sure.
So you were saying that after the pre-screening process,
yeah,
then the committee gets the list of people who are going to be cut.
Right.
And that's when people on the committee can go, oh, but that's Tennessee Williams and he's great, they just don't get it. Like, where they can save someone, they can be like, no, this person shouldn't be cut.
Right. Yes, they can do, yes. And it could be for any number of reasons. Not most of the time it's that they want the committee to read. They want that person discussed in the first meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that maybe that yes? So they say can say one person.
Gosh.
Yeah.
No. Which just sounds like a little reality showy. Like you can say one player.
Right.
I know.
True. Yeah, because I feel like the other thing to say is that the writers are very generous towards other writers. You know, and so you know we want to keep their numbers manageable at the same time allowing them a say in where people are going at what point in the process. So that's where that came from. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Well, I'm afraid this is going to get even deeper into the weeds, but you're, I know you said getting the details apart, but it occurred to me as you just described that and after following his question, sorry, I don't remember your name, but Jay's question, it maybe would be helpful to people here and people listening, I don't want to be presumptuous, but maybe it would be helpful, despite you and Todd explaining that the Dramatists doesn't look for a particular genre or content or gender or whatever, but it might be helpful to hear what the qualitative descriptors are, because if we're choosing plays that we want to submit for you to evaluate, if we know, since you have now come up with evaluation descriptions and categories and a hierarchy based on that, perhaps if you can share that with us, it might help us pick a play that we think might have a better shot at making it beyond that.
I would say this about them. I mean, we keep them as open as possible. They're not, I mean, only because I would say, and I will share them with you, but what I would say is, can't second guess because ultimately the decision is the committee's, and you never know how that committee is going to respond to your work. So if you're trying to second guess them, or then what, rather than the terms are more like, you know, great craft, great voice, you know, I feel passionate about this. So it's more about how they're reading than what you're submitting, because and then they provide the description. Because I guess we would never want to dictate or try to influence what you send. Because my response to what you should send is what you feel represents you the best, and that you're on fire about. I say this every year, that send the thing you feel the most passionate about, because ultimately that might ignite the passion in the readers. So in terms of the terms there, you know, strong voice, strong craft, I love this play, I want to know more about this. I'm not sure if this play should move on. This is a weak voice, or the voice is interesting but not yet formed. You know, and so it's more about that than, you know, this is a farce with six characters, and it's, you know, it's not, there's no categories as far as what you're submitting. It's more about how they're trying to read the work.
And as Emily explained it to me, it was kind of like, you know, you have certain readers who, everyone was at 7, 8, or 9. Because they went in really nice. Everyone, no one was, they didn't get, no one was a 1 to 6. Everyone was either 7, 8, or 9. And then there were others who didn't go over 6 at all. So all
their highest was 6.
So the point is, how do you take those two points of view and kind of coalesce them. Do you know what I mean? So that's the reason for that. So it's really because someone else was like, I can't give anybody below a 7. And so the plays that they thought the weakest would get a 7, whereas someone else on the committee, if they thought they were weak, would give them a 2. So it's really a way of kind of trying to figure out what's in the heads of the writers, really, of the readers.
Yeah,
you know?
I understand
that. So it wasn't about...
This side feels like such a mystery that I felt
like right. It wasn't about subject. It wasn't about genre. It wasn't about style. It was really just about...
It still basically leaves it in a subjective form for them. Do you know? So it's compelling voice, compelling execution, compelling voice, skilled craft. I mean, these are things that they're...
Right.
Also having to interpret, and that's why, again, we ask them to provide supportive notes, because then we see what they mean by that, and then we, you know, so that's part of how we track that for them, too, especially as John was saying, you know, we had some people fall in this sixth category, which is evidence of voice, last craft, should this playwright continue, and we, you know, I think inevitably playwrights pushed back and said, well, I would say they lack craft, but I think this is a solid 6. So then we had to debate, what do we do with those people? And inevitably they said, we should move them on. We want to talk about that. What does that mean? So, and they, at the end of the process, are always asked, sort of, how did you feel about the process? And so these are things that 6 category was the most challenging. And they're really being asked, should this go forward at this point? You know. So is that helpful? Yeah, okay.
I just wanted to add to what John was saying, and as far as the numbers in the pre-screening round, we really do look at, like, for instance, if there is an alumni reader that is reading at like everything a 9 or, you know, super high numbers, we also look at that and kind of make a special note, you know, because if there's someone else that has read like that given play and has rated it a really low number, we will notate that. So it's like any kind of system that you put on this process, which is a very, you know, idiosyncratic and complex and thorough and nuanced process. Mm-hmm. I guess the comfort I would like take in all of that is that there are the whole process is very human. So despite like numbers in certain sections, and despite that it's online and that you're submitting online, there's always staff members that are like, we're looking out for those instances where we're like, wait a minute, like, you know, oftentimes Emily and I will go back and forth about, you know, questions, you know, in regards to especially the beginning part of the admissions process, and we'll raise those to each other because we want to give everyone.
And that's part of why, just to add, that's part of why we put the terms, because we were seeing a lot more of that kind of like, this is a 9, this is a 9, this is a 9, you know, and then other people like John was saying 6, 6, 6, 6, but this is the best play ever. So that's why we started, we have to kind of define what these numbers mean to us, but for them.
I actually am really clear after
hearing the process. You're going to be dreaming.
as we move the piece on. So there's no limit to what they can do, and they can keep working on the same piece. So quite often, some of the writers will actually use the various different types of programs to sort of shepherd